got your Bible tonight, come with us to 1 Peter. Look at 1 Peter chapter 1. Now, I'm going to try to be real still tonight and stay where you can see me. Baby put me on a diet Monday and I only gained 3 pounds. So as I waste away up here, went to a funeral Sunday and listened to a preacher, and you know, Preacher Tim has talked about this quite a bit, and matter of fact, he even mentioned it Sunday in his message Sunday morning about how do you preach funerals whenever you know they're saved, you don't know they're saved, or you're pretty sure they wasn't saved. And he told you something my granddad used to say, and he'd say if they were saved, he'd preach them into the arms of Jesus. He'd say if they was lost, he'd preach to the family. But then he'd say if he didn't know, he'd preach them to the brink of the Jordan and let whoever owned them come pick them up. And we left church Sunday, went to a funeral out of town, and this preacher got up, and first thing he said was, "Now, I don't want to preach this man into heaven." And then he did his best to try to preach him into heaven. He reached way back into the 60s, to a time during the Vietnam War when this gentleman went to a little church out in Texas. He prayed and asked Christ into his heart. He said nothing of his life. He said nothing of his dedication to God. He said nothing of his attendance to church, his giving and tithes. He said nothing about the life the man lived, only he encouraged his sons. "You can be sure Daddy's in heaven, because way back there in 1968, he prayed and asked the Lord to save him." And I got to thinking this week, that's not how I want to leave this world. And I'm sure many of you feel the same way. I want somebody to be able to say that at some time in his life, he honored God. At some time in his life, he did something that was meaningful and brought glory to the cause of Christ. And tonight, I want to preach to you a message, and I'm going to title it simply, "Our Obligation." And I want you to think as we read the Scripture tonight, just what is your obligation? If you stand in honor to read God's Word, we'll begin reading in verse 9. 1 Peter chapter 1, the Bible says, "Receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls, of which salvation, notice, the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you, searching what, or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ, which was in them, did signify," notice, "when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow." Your mind immediately goes back to the prophet Isaiah. He told us about how Jesus would come and he'd be hated by all men, and they would persecute him and beat him to the point that not even anyone could recognize who he was. The prophets, they foretold all of these things, and we're able to enjoy them tonight. Verse 12 says, "Unto whom it was revealed, that not unto themselves, but unto us, they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things," notice, "the angels desire to look into." Verse 13 says, "Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end, for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ, as obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lust in your ignorance, but as he which hath called you to be is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. Verse 16 says, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. Let's pray tonight. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you tonight as humbly as we know how. Lord, on this Wednesday night, dear Lord, a time of prayer service, a time of a Bible study, a time of looking into your word, and Lord, this pick-me-up time, dear Lord, that we need you to breathe strength into our lives that we can make it, Lord, until this Sunday. Lord, it's like the car that runs out of gas, dear Lord. If he could just get to that pump, Lord, he could go forward in his life. And Lord, I ask you for that tonight. Would you, Lord, fill our tanks, dear Lord, that we might be beneficial to the cause of Christ. We might do something when we leave this place, dear Lord, that bring glory unto the name of Jesus. And Lord, it's my prayer tonight, dear Lord, if there's anyone in this church, myself included, Lord, that we need to get more serious and be more obligated, Lord, in the things that you left us here to do. Lord, would you stir our hearts tonight? Lord, would you make us better fit for your service? In Jesus' sweet and holy name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. I want to say this tonight, that our obligations go right along with our salvation. God didn't save us and forget us. He didn't save us and say, live like you want to. He didn't save us and say, I'll never have any request of you. No, God saved us. And we said it the last time I preached. He redeemed us. We have been redeemed by the blood of Christ. That was our redemption, the time that we were saved. And continually, we are being saved through sanctification. We are being separated more from the world and separated unto the cause of Christ. Until that day, as Paul said, we will be glorified. Our glorification, that day that we will be eternally saved and in the presence of our King. Can I say we ought to rejoice in such a great salvation tonight? It ought to make us happy that we can say tonight with a clear conscience and a whole heart, that I know who Jesus is. It ought to make us happy tonight that we can say that because our salvation came at such a great cost, that we have eternal life through the blood of Jesus Christ. But friend, I say to you also, we should fulfill the great obligation that's been given to us. We were created in Jesus, the Bible says, unto good works. Now, I like what the old writer said, that works don't prove our salvation, but they sure show proof of our salvation. You can take a lot of people tonight, they can do a lot of things in the cause of Christ and be lost. They might be able to preach, they might be able to teach, they might be able to sing, but they cannot avoid, they cannot overlook their own salvation. But dear friend, there's a call that God has given us as His children. And the Bible says that He foreordained that we should walk in them. The Bible tells us quite plainly we are new creations in Christ Jesus. That means we're not anything of what we used to be. Now the problem there is we still live in the same flesh that we've always lived in. And the Bible separates our flesh from our spirit by saying this, that the spirit and the flesh are at enmity between each other. In other words, they're mortal enemies. They're eternal enemies. They will never be friends. They will never get along. They'll never be able to occupy the same place without causing a mess in our life. But the Bible says, old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. I got to thinking today just how much of the old things have truly passed away. How much of the new things have been displayed in our life? You see, we're quick tonight to put aside our obligations, to put aside those responsibilities that we have to the cause of Christ. But I'm here to tell you tonight that one day judgment shall come. The Bible says that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that He is Lord. That's the saved and the lost. But the judgment separates there, and there's two different judgments. The one is to the judgment seat of Christ. That Bema seat where the Bible says, for we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And the Bible says we'll give an account for every deed that has been done in this body, whether good or bad. And what the Bible describes to us at that particular time, as Jesus goes to reward those saints who have now entered into His presence in heaven, and for eternity we're going to enjoy or we're going to miss what God intended for us to have. And the Bible says that He's going to take those works that we've done in this Christian life, and He's going to cast them into that holy refining fire. And the Bible says that only those things such as gold and silver and precious stones are going to last the fire. That's our reward. But everything that didn't please God is going to be burnt up as hay, wood, and stubble. And we'll miss those rewards eternally. I want you to know tonight that those that aren't saved will stand before the great white throne judgment. And my friend, that's a terrible place to finally be. For the Bible says that everyone who stands before the great white throne will be cast into the lake of fire. Many of you have children, as I have. And many might be grandparents tonight. Or you might be a young person that's growing up. We all have to testify that this generation that is upon us today is a last day generation. And the generation that is upon us today don't want to uphold obligations. Everybody seems to want to have the easy way. We think if our cell phone gets cut off, that it's the end of the world. We think if we don't have cable TV or satellite TV, that we're just living in poverty. We're used to pushing buttons and things happening. We're used to working less and rewarding more. Our political system is so corrupt, you don't know who to believe. My granddad used to say it's easy to tell when a politician's lying. He's just talking. And if he's talking, he's usually lying. We're constantly reading in the news where school teachers are getting in trouble for saying things positive about Christianity. And we see where they slap them on the wrist when they promote homosexuality and transgender lifestyles in our public schools. And it's really hard today to discern what is true and what is false in a Christian's testimony. But tonight I want to help you as God has helped me. And I want you to notice verse 13 with me tonight as we'll begin with our points. Verse 13 begins by saying, wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind. Can I say to you tonight that any time, it is a good principle to know, as you are studying God's Word, that any time that word wherefore comes up, in order to understand what God has given out after the wherefore, you have to go back to the previous verses and find out what it's because of. If you were to look with me tonight in verse 1 through 3, you'd find out that the wherefore speaks of a great salvation. Notice as the writer begins to tell us in verse 1, he says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. He said they are the elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Grace unto you and peace be multiplied. Notice verse 3, he says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto the lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. My dear friend, I want you to know tonight that as the Apostle Peter looked, he saw that there were those Jews that were scattered amongst the land. You say, why were they scattered? Because they were being persecuted for their faith in Christ. They were afraid to assemble together. They were afraid to join a group because they would be identified and they would be persecuted even more. But Peter is trying to get them to understand that this salvation that we have is a great salvation that has come through and by the shed blood of Jesus. We are nothing but to be suffering for Christ. We are nothing but to be persecuted with Him. The Apostle Paul said of all the things in this world he could glory in, he gloried save in the cross of Jesus Christ. He counted it an honor and a blessing to suffer the persecution that came with being a Christian. My friends, when we begin to think what the wherefore speaks of, it speaks of a great salvation. In verse 4, it speaks of a great reward. Notice the Bible says, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that fadeth not away. Notice he said, reserved in heaven for you. Friend, we have a great reward. We have a great reward because God is faithful and because God is true and because God loves you and He has better things in store for you than a sin-cursed world that brings about suffering and shame. Then the wherefore speaks in verse 5 of God's great grace. Notice he said, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Aren't you glad tonight that God's hand isn't slippery as we would think sometimes? I'm here to tell you that whenever you accept Christ as your Savior, and you continually are being saved through sanctification, and you're looking forward to the day that you will be glorified and stand in His presence and enjoy His person for eternity, we can say tonight that God is able to keep that He's committed unto Himself. We're kept for that final day. The Bible says we are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation. Then we also have a great joy. The Bible says, wherein, in verse 6, you greatly rejoice. Though now for a season, if need be, you are in heaviness through manifold temptations. Do you realize with me tonight that God expects us to be joyous Christians? I've given you an example before of what that joy represents. If you could imagine tonight a football and kids out in the backyard playing with these footballs. Hey, if you can just imagine Tom Brady. You let a little bit of air out of that ball and you lose a little bit of control. You can't kick it quite as far and you sure can't treat it with 300 pounds falling on it. Multiple men falling on it. Because, see, when it has a little bit of air, it'll bust. Oh, but you fill it to capacity with air. And now you can throw it as far as your strength can. You can kick it as hard as you want. And the whole team can fall on it, and it'll never bust. That's the joy that God puts in His Christians, His saints. And we can enjoy that joy tonight. Because it's God's love, it's God's presence that fills us. Then the wherefore speaks of His promise. Verse 9, He said, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. And then it concludes in verse 10 through 12 that we have a great privilege. The Bible says, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. In other words, the prophets received the word from God, but they did not see the results of the prophecy. As Abraham looked at that ram that was caught in the thicket, and he took that ram and he took Isaac from the altar and placed the ram on the altar, he for once saw a substitutionary sacrifice that would die in place of his son. It was a picture of the cross, and Hebrews 11 tells us that these all looked forward in faith, not having received the promise, but having believed it from afar. Do you realize what a privilege it is tonight? What a privilege it is not to be an Old Testament saint and look forward in hope of what God is going to do, but to be able to be a New Testament saint and be able to look back to a place in history, a place in time where Jesus hung on the cross, a moment in time where they put Him in the grave, and 3 days later He arose victorious. So beginning in verse 13, we begin to see our great obligation to God. I want you to notice with me tonight, I got 7 things and I'm going to go through them really, really quick. But we have an obligation tonight to be strong in the Lord. Verse 13 tells us, "Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind." Do you realize tonight that our mind can be one of our greatest enemies? The word gird there means to actually tuck in. In the old times, the men would wear these tunics, so to speak, and they would have the garb around them, and they would gird up their tunic and tuck it in so that they could move about and they could run and they wouldn't trip over what they were wearing. And don't you know today in our generation we see so many people tripping over their own thoughts. We see people tripping over religion. They trip over spiritual things. They trip over things that they don't need to even be involved in. The Bible says to gird up our loins of our mind, and it means that we're to be prepared for the race that's at hand. Joshua 24:15 says, "And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose this day whom ye'll serve, whether the gods of which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell." But Joshua said, "But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Can I say to you tonight that when we're strong in our mind, when we're strong in our loins, then we cannot be moved as other men are, but we can be steadfast and we can be unmovable, abounding in the work of God by saying that I am for God, He is for me. And the question's been answered. Ephesians 6 and 10 says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might." So we have an obligation to be strong in God. We also have an obligation to be sober in our mind. Verse 13 says, "Be sober and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ." That word sober there means to be focused. Can I say to you tonight, it is important for us to accept the obligation of staying focused on the task at hand. It's not for us to be in this race and watch everything on the outside of the race and get distracted, and before you know it, we're not even running. We're trying to enjoy the things that we've imagined or that we saw. Why is it important we stay focused? My friend, because Satan tonight is focused. We should stay focused at the task at hand. That is getting to glory. That is taking our family and our friends, everyone that we can, lead them to the cause of Christ. Because the devil stays focused on destroying and devouring. 1 Peter 5 and 8 says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour." 1 Thessalonians 5 and 6 says, "Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober." The Bible says in 1 Peter 4 and 7, "But the end of all things is at hand. Be ye sober and watch unto prayer." My friend, we must stay focused on what God is doing. We as a church tonight, we have to stay focused. We have to stay focused that it's all about lost people being saved. It's not about programs. It's not about fun. It's not about entertainment. It's about the lost that are dying and giving them the gospel. We also have an obligation to be steadfast in our walk. Do you know tonight that the Bible says that we are to hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you? Notice he says that the revelation of Jesus Christ. We're to have hope to the end. We're not to stop. We're not to say, I've done enough. I pastored for some 16 years. It'd be easy tonight to sit down and say, hey, you know what? For 16 years, I went to hospitals and visited. For 16 years, I studied every day. For 16 years, I preached at least 3 times a week. For 16 years, I presented the gospel. For 16 years, I did this and I did that. So I've done enough, and I'm just going to sit back and just ask God to reward me for what I've done. But man, I kind of enjoy it sometimes when Preacher Tim has to be gone. I realize I ain't got a whole lot left in me anymore, but God does. And I might not be able to run like I used to, but thank God I can keep walking. And God can keep blessing. But it's my obligation not to sit down and quit. It's not to be of a double mind, thinking 2 different ways about the same thing. I told you one time about being double-minded. I picked on my daughter. Had a swimming pool in the backyard, above-ground pool. And I noticed one day that while she was home, she went into the shower. She got out of the shower, and for some reason, she uses 3 towels. She wraps one around her head, one around her body, and she stands on the other one. And I'm sitting on the couch, I'm studying, and she goes, Daddy, turn your head. What for? I got to go to the laundry room and get some clothes. So we had that whole debate about why didn't you get clothes before you took a shower, you know. So I closed my eyes and turned my head, and she come through the house. Day or two passed, and I'm still sitting on the couch, still studying some, and here she comes through with a towel thrown over her shoulder and a bikini, going out to the pool. And I said, hey, we got a problem here. If I got to turn my head for you wearing the same thing coming out of a shower, why don't I have to turn my head for you walking through the house in a bikini? And she said, Daddy, they're different. But let's be honest, they're not. If we're not careful tonight, we won't be so steadfast and stand. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:58, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know, notice that your labor is not in vain. You have an obligation tonight to God to not change. To not move with every wind of doctrine. Do not let discouragement knock you over. Do not let family and friends pull you away. I got a niece one time. I was giving her some advice she didn't want. She told me, she said, I can't live up to your standard. I got to thinking, man, I can't either. But I sure am going to try. Don't you get tired of not being what you should be? Don't you get sick sometimes of not measuring up to what you know you can? Hey, I'm a realist tonight. I know the devil catches you off guard, but sometimes he don't have to catch us off guard. Sometimes all he has to do is show us an open door. Steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. 2 Peter 3:17 says this, "Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness." It's time we as Christian people nail down the fact that God's Word is right and the world is wicked. The world wants to propagate and tell us what God is saying. My friend, I don't have to take anybody's word. It says what it says. I heard an old preacher years ago, and he said, you know, if you'll listen to the word from the world, you'll find that God says things different ways. You ever heard anybody make the statement, well, I read this and it says this to me, and somebody else will say, well, I read this and it says this to me. Well, one of them's wrong. You see, men can change what God said. They'll never, ever, ever change what He meant. It's up to you and I to stay steadfast and unmovable so that we always know the intention of God and always know what God expects so that we can please Him. Then we have an obligation to be submissive to the Lord. Verse 14 says, As obedient children, do you know tonight one of the worst words you can ask somebody to accept in their life is to be obedient to someone else's authority? Man, on the highway patrol, we had 10-15 guys here at different times working, and you'd have one boss man, and everybody else had to be in subjection to that one boss man, and he would give out orders, and we were simply to obey him. But don't you know we would get along, and we'd get in our little groups, and man, we'd run him down, and I ain't doing what he says. He can go do that himself, you know. Oh, don't laugh. Y'all do it too. I just have to talk about the highway patrol because I ain't got a job. Submissive as children. I'm glad, I am so glad I had the mom and dad I had. I never had a problem obeying my daddy. He got my attention when I was little, and he kept my attention. He climbed poles for a living. He was strong. I remember one time my mom told me, if you do this again, I'm going to give you a whipping. And I didn't believe her, so I did it again. She made me sit on the couch and wait for Daddy. Daddy said, you told him you was going to whip him, so here's the belt, you whip him. And she started whipping me, and Brother Robert, it didn't hurt. And Daddy sat over there on the couch, and he started laughing. So I started laughing. Then Mama started crying. Then Daddy got up from the couch and Mike started crying. But obedience. The Bible says it's better to obey than to sacrifice. Church, tonight I'm telling you, it's hard to get children to obey their parents today. I believe because it's hard to get parents to obey God today. Hey, you might not always be popular. I'll just be honest, I ain't popular with my daughter right now. But I ain't changing. Man, I was at the point of death with Tony, and not a preaching. I might not be preaching good, but I'm still preaching. I could have been dead. But God's been good. And I can look back over my life at the friends that was there at different times. And I can tell you the things that happened and made them leave. But excuse me, I've done a lot of things in my life. God ain't never left me. My goodness, He just forgives more and more. Ephesians 4:1 says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you were called. If God didn't think you could do it, He wouldn't have gave it to you to do. So let's nail it down and do it. then we have an obligation to stay separated from the world. Verse 14 says, "Be obedient as children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lust in your ignorance." Can I say to you tonight, aren't you glad that we have some maturity in our Christian life? Aren't you glad we're not that little baby we were when we prayed and asked Jesus to save us? Aren't you glad that we've been able to read and been able to be preached to and taught in Sunday school and Bible studies? What thus saith the Word of God? And we have a knowledge tonight of our great Creator. There's some things that we can talk about our liberty in. The Apostle Paul got hungry one day and he looked on a false idol's offering. And I just imagine Brother Robert's probably a good looking steak. And here they worshiping this false god, and now this steak is so sacred because it's being offered to a false god. And the Apostle Paul said, "Hey, I'd like to eat that steak because that god ain't real. If the God ain't real, the sacrifice ain't real." But people started getting offended, and Paul said, "I'll put my liberty aside so that I might win some." It wasn't that Paul was wrong, but Paul said, "There's some things ain't worth fighting over if I can lead this person to Christ. But then there's some things that's just wrong." There's some things we don't have to dig far in the Word of God to realize, hey, if we do them, we're doing wrong. And a lot of the things that's going on in this world today in the form of Christianity is nothing short of wrong. We've got terminology like Christian rock music. Hey, if you want to listen to rock, listen to rock. But you ain't got to smear the name of Christ in some of that ungodly music. I've often wondered, where's it going to stop? According to the news, we must have some Christian pornography out there because more and more preachers by the wayside are falling. The Bible says, according to the former lust that was in our ignorance. Don't you know tonight, church, that if it's Christian, it'll glorify God. If it's called Christian and don't glorify God, it's not Christian. I heard a preacher say this one time about Christian music. He says, if it's Christian, it'll move your heart before it moves your foot. It'll be more about the words than the melody. It'll be more about the content than the message. Than the music. We could go on about dress, language, conversations. I sit in church Sunday in another church and heard a guy cuss. I ain't talking about a slang cuss. I'm talking about something we all can agree was cussing. They're just words. That's what people say. The Bible says to separate ourselves from the world. Two more and I'm done tonight. We'll pray. We have an obligation to stay serious about sin. Verse 15 says, "So be ye holy." The word holy means not just to be separated, but to be a cut above. If you can imagine a butcher as they lay a piece of beef out in front of them, and that butcher, having been schooled or trained and having the experience, he knows how to take that knife and cut away the choice meat from the common. You see, you don't grind filet mignon in the hamburger, because then you can't charge $20 a plate for it. That butcher knows what it's like to separate, and he'll bring out the things that are a cut above the rest. And when God says, "Be ye holy," That's what he's saying. He's saying, I'm above everything. If you're going to be somewhat like me, you're going to have to be not just separated, but a cut above. What's he saying? He's saying sin is serious. 2 Thessalonians 1 and 10 says this, when he shall come to be glorified in his saints and be admired, and all them that believe, wherefore also we pray always to you that our God would count you worthy of his calling and fulfill all the good pleasure of his goodness and the work of faith with power, that the name of our Lord Jesus Christ may be glorified in you and ye in him according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Once again, preacher, why do I have to be so serious about sin? Because the devil's serious. The devil's serious tonight. You see, you might preach it one day and not live it the next, but the devil's message never changes. He's the same devil that was in the garden. As he said to Eve, wait a minute, you misunderstood what God was saying. And he's ruining this generation. Statistics say that unless something changes, in the next 20 years, organized religion will not have structures to worship in. Because where churches used to be filled, tonight they're barren. When I was in Bible college, a man came from the country of Wales. Brother Tony, he begged and he begged and he pleaded if anybody would hear the call of God to come to Wales. There's churches everywhere that are empty. You can have any ministry that you want. All you got to do is go and take over one of those little churches. Get out and start witnessing. Start preaching. Preacher, what's so bad about that? Have you ever heard of the Welsh Revival? One of the greatest revivals that ever took place in the history of the church. And today, churches are barren. I had a friend one time tell me that he'd been a Christian so long, certain sins didn't bother him no more. And I told him quite plainly, it's because you redefined what sin is. You'll battle sin to the day you die. God said, if you say you have no sin, then you call God a liar and the truth's not in you. Sin's not what offends you and I, it's what offends God. And my goodness, I don't believe you could get a notebook and write it all down. I believe God is offended at our blatant sin. We have an obligation tonight to keep it serious. And then tonight we have an obligation to be spared from eternal judgment. And I told you about the judgment seat of Christ. Preacher Jack Laster told me one time, he said, from what I've seen traveling around from church to church, he said, all I can say is the judgment seat of Christ is going to be an interesting place. But I came to tell you this tonight. Not only do we have an obligation to spare ourselves from God's judgment, we also have a reward for doing right. I don't know about you tonight, but man, I get really tired. I get really tired of listening to people talk about how cheap salvation is. Friend, it's free tonight, but it's not cheap. And if your testimony when you leave this world is that way back in a little church in 1968, you said a prayer, but can't nobody look in that casket and say, man, I tell you what, that guy knew some Bible. Man, that guy could sing. Man, that guy could preach, he could teach, could tell you about the souls that's been won to Christ. And if we don't want that kind of testimony, we got to start fulfilling some obligations. Let's bow our heads for prayer tonight. Dear Father God, Lord, I love you and I praise you and I thank you tonight, dear Lord. Lord, I thank you for allowing us to get through the message, dear Lord, to the time of, Lord, decision. And I know tonight in my own life, dear Lord, I could obligate my life so much more. Lord, I believe you open more doors for me than I've had open. Lord, that's my prayer, and I'm certain tonight there's someone else here tonight that's praying the same. Lord, if I'll just start taking sin more serious, take a stand, quit moving about and trying not to offend people, but realize they're already offended at Christ. Lord, help us tonight to be that church, that light that's on a hill, where souls are still being saved. Lord, I love you and I praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. As you stand tonight. One verse tonight. Would you come? Preacher, I just want to obligate myself closer to the Lord. I'm going to tell you, there's a lot of things I don't know that God would honor, but He'll honor that. Like that bride that stands in front of a church. No wrinkles in her gown. No smudges in her makeup. Her hair's not disheveled. That's the bride God wants. A glorified church. A glorified body. Staying in the fight. What about you tonight? Heads bowed tonight. Music's going to play softly. Would you be honest with God tonight? Do you really take sin as serious as you should? Hey, I know what it's like just being a parent. We want to give our children everything. But there ain't nothing you can give them more precious than Jesus. There's no better advice than pray. And there's no better thing you can be than an example. Amen. I appreciate your attention tonight.